I have another one too. I wrote down repetitive stress disorder. Remember the polar bear?
Oh,
the polar
bear. About, that's called repetitive stress disorder.
I think it's called repetitive stress disorder. Check it out, man.
No, it's
check
not.
Check out the internet. It's not?
Like no, I just tested it.
Oh,
cool.
Wait, do you know like polar bears are like?
There was a polar bear at the San Francisco Zoo that you'd go every time I went. He was just going back and forth every time. He'd go all day long.
They call it zoosis. Psychosis caused by confinement.
Oh, really?
It's very common, including repeatedly vomiting and eating your own vomit.
Ooh, gross.
And gorillas that sob. Oh, that'd be so sad. Sobbing gorilla. And compulsively masturbating walrus.
That's awesome. How does a walrus masturbate?
Oh, here, YouTube. Walrus is masturbating.
There's a video of it.
Is that their back feet?
Oh,
oh man.
God.
Oh, jeez. Oh.
All right.
I'm learning a lot.
Well, the secret of my age is long.
Do you hear that it's 8 minutes long?
I guess stalker is with mine.
Holy shit, that was disturbing. Hey, yo, you guys are lucky.
Hey, if it was bad, God would have made his fin smaller. Come on. Started brainstorming ideas for Psychonauts 2.
The idea now is not to just talk about Psychonauts sequel. We're talking about VR experiences.
As kind of a missing mission between Psychonauts 1 and 2.
It's a hard game to make. It's a really hard game to make. And they're trying to do some stuff that's like, you know, it's basically never been done before.
One of our longest term employees leaving the company, Ray Crook and Chad Dawson, will be co-project leading GVR. It's awesome.
So yeah, we'll see how it goes. Oh, no.
Excellent. Awesome. Let's talk about GVR. Thanks for sitting close to each other, you guys. And thanks for not wearing a creepy foil finger, Chad.
I'll put it down.
What happened last week in the world of in the exciting world of virtual reality?
I'll let you go since you got the finger.
Okay. So we finished the 5XP, 5M experience. We had quite a few people, 10 or so, come and try it. And got a lot of really good feedback. Things that were good, things that are bad. So that was encouraging. Yeah, we've been doing some cool stuff with Martin's been working on with just sort of the space with the Rhombus of Ruin and what that's going to look like.
Hasn't been
good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Busy.
This is just the check-in project leader style that we set up. Also, because you guys are new project leaders, how do you guys like being project leaders? I'm a strong believer that when you're first time leading a project, you should have a partner. Like, they had a tentacle, me and Dave. And it, because your first time leading a project, at least I was really intimidated. You have the little self-doubt of like, should I be running this? Does everyone think I'm crazy? And then you have this other partner and they're like, yeah, they do. They think we're all crazy. What are we gonna do about that? I don't know. And you can just talk like that with somebody. And having an ally is just really important because it's lonely at the top.
Are you still able to do your first jobs? This is mostly my lesson to explain my problem with writing deadlines. So you guys will understand my problem
with
writing.
It's true.
Yeah, you don't do what you're good at, right? Yeah, I think it happens to everybody. I think everybody that's has a specialty, you know, you eventually move into management and you start, and you get to do less and less of what you enjoy doing.
I treasure the days I actually get a check-in code that works and runs, and I feel like a programmer again.
This skill that you've been trying to hone and practice, and that you love doing, you start losing it, right? I mean, you start losing it to some degree, but when you're not doing it, you just become rusty at it.
I've always loved Ray's animation in particular, ever since I worked with him on Brutal. He added so much to characters, it's been a little frustrating not getting to see him kind of put that Ray charm on the characters. Yeah, it's a shift. Hopefully it's a net win. Both of us have been around for a while now. There's a lot we have to offer. You know, I try to think some of these new guys are scary to think they might be, you know, 20 years younger than me or whatever, you know, 15 or more years in the industry less. I try to think when I started, I didn't have many people that much difference of experience, how nice it might have been to have someone with that amount of experience give me a little bit of mentorship, give me a little bit of leadership, steer me in the right way, help me become a better programmer faster. You start to recognize that you have something to offer on that you didn't even know that you had, you know. And that can be a good thing. Most on this project since then has been not only leadership, but also on the design side with sort of a design team of sorts.
So you need to find music. You know you have to find music somehow. And so you're searching around and you find the music box, but it's broken. You CV into the rat. That's next.
The rat.
The rat. I don't know. Just go with it. Yeah. And the last piece is a little too small to fix. So you have to CV into the bed bug. Mm-hmm. Get even smaller. Or the flea on the back of the rat. And take that little like grain of sand or something and knock it off. And then
once you pull that thing out, it just starts going. That's better.
So if you try and crank it from the outside, just goes tick, 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 it just won't move.
It's like already wound up.
Yeah, it's overcranked.
Yeah.
Okay. And so once you remove the thing, it just starts playing.
And then it starts playing.
Okay. I have high hopes for that team because Emily has turned out to just be a creative powerhouse, just comes up with tons of ideas. She comes to every meeting with like 8 post-it notes to lay out some idea she had. And I'm like, I didn't bring any post-it notes, man. And I was like, that overachiever, I need to put her down. No, she's like, you know, I found a lot of times someone's here at the company for one profession or one area of expertise, but you get them to a brainstorming meeting, they're just this fountain of like, what about this? What about this? What about this? And that's so valuable.
I don't know how I did that, but I did. I just started bringing in like weird design stuff and just presenting it. I just had ideas, and I just think that that's a fun thing to do, is to sort of design story and what happens, and you know, try to think about what I think would be cool in a game.
That can always be a little bit tricky without someone, you know, being the de facto design lead. Particularly bring Tim in with his busy schedule, him not being able to make it to all the meetings and being on sort of a different page than us. I think it took us a little while to get that going.
Emily has a good idea that we could avoid that maybe.
Hey, there you are.
So then maybe stabilize the bus, maybe not if we don't go that way.
Neither of us, I think, really expected to kind of have to fill that in as much.
We're going to continue on Mia's?
Yeah.
Okay.
On the bus.
I feel like you should be able to do like turn signal, windshield wipers.
Yeah, right. Use all those stupid things. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Once the bus has power, yeah. It does not.
Maybe if he can get the power restored in the bus, he can get it going. So the trick to this one is you're at a dashboard here, and there's a stop sign and a hood, and if I hit this button, it pops the hood open, and the hood actually kind of pops from the front, so you can see it from the driver's point of view down in the hood, and you see that the battery's dead or missing, but you can't do much about it. But then there's a bunch of sharks and eels circling. But as you put out the stop sign, it's kind of like musical chairs. They all kind of stop. So if you're quick and you can stop and catch an electric eel, then you can pop the hood and catch the electric eel, and he replaces the battery, and now you have power to the radio.
But we got the stop sign eel in the hood thing.
The electric eel made it.
Eel in the hood.
That was a joke.
Man, the eel's in the hood. We've hit that point in the meeting where anything's funny.
All right.
Very dangerous. Very dangerous.
But particularly as he started getting the idea to do Psychonauts 2, his focus has been more on that.
All grasslands are starting to warm up because I'm starting to actually pull that back my design documents, because next week is the art jam for grasslands as Scott Campbell and Nathan Stapley are gonna be coming to town, and Peter Chan. I'd be holed up in the back room drawing stuff, talking about grasslands for you guys. That's Psychonauts 2. That's our code name for Psychonauts 2. So we're just getting ready for that, which is good, because get that started, because we need to get some of those things, just for the design of the game would be good, but also to, you just made the craziest face at me right now. Matt was yawning and then doing the, I'm gonna hide a yawn, and it turned into like a death mask, kind of. And I happened to catch it right when I was talking. It scared me. But also, some of the art will obviously be helpful when you start our campaign for Grasslands on Fig.
Whenever Grasslands is going to start, pre-production is going to start, you know Tim's just going to start taking our people. He's going to take Emily. He's going to try to take Bagel. Right? I mean, the people that he is saying, hey, I want them in the art jam, which is Emily and Bagel, are both our artists.
You know, we were a studio that we all worked on Psychonauts, and then we all worked on Brutal Legend, and then we went to four projects, and it was tricky. It was definitely tricky to balance all of the people and the needs.
You know, so it's like the fact that he identified Emily as somebody that he wanted, I think is actually really great for the company, because it means that Tim is recognizing that there are people in the studio who have good design ideas, can produce great art, and that we don't have, I mean, yes, we've got all these people that we love working with, Scott and Peter, but cultivating that talent from within, I think, is really important too. So,
right.
You know, I'm okay. Totally pleased that he asked for her by name.
Okay. Grasslands is only starting to emerge as a thing. Mm-hmm. And then until Tim really has a good design worked out, I can't imagine that he's going to have a huge team of content creators until we know what it is that we're building.
Anything else?
That's all I can think of. It'd be great to have you next week.
Yeah,
hopefully you can come. Cool. All right. Okay, thanks, guys.
Okay, bye.
I also really like Chad and Ray, and I think it's a great opportunity for two guys who've been at the company for a long time and are really good at what they do to have a chance to take on, a new responsibility, a new challenge. Whether it's overwhelming or not for them, I don't know. But, you know, but they're doing a really great job. They have a lot of respect from the people in the company. So it's fun to see them in that role.
I'm trying to get an hour of time. You want this? You want that? An important dude.
He's still sitting in his place.
It's all mixed up. That those three chairs are usually here.
Hi, everybody. Hello. Please, there's a lot of people here to welcome this first at Double Fine. We have to welcome Scott Campbell. Scott Campbell is here. Nathan Bagel Stapley is in the house. Yep. Peter Chan is right there, Mr. Peter Chan. So yeah, a lot of people are old friends from out of town here to help remind me what Psychonauts is so we can start working on Grasslands. But we have been locked up in the cold room brainstorming and talking about ideas for things so they can have an art jam and draw some of the first art for the sequel to Psychonauts that we are going to be crowdfunding in December.
Fig. It's like throwing it out there.
Which we are going to be figging. How's it going so far, you guys?
Pretty good.
Yeah. So more like high noon for Magnificent Seven. All these guys are coming to town. And Bagel's like the really good swordsman who's drunk all the time.
Like Jackson Pollock.
Hey, you guys, thanks for doing that.
Dude, I'm down with trying some markers.
And all your old markers are like still here from the Brutal Legend art.
And probably dry as a bone.
Probably dry as a bone. Oh my God, what are you eating? That's crazy.
I'm gonna eat this whole donut
myself. Oh good, yeah, I was gonna tell you, there's a box of donuts.
Wait, stand right here, just get it ready. Yeah.
That looks muscular.
Yeah, it is like, yeah.
Like a big muscle arm.
You know how I love art jams. I like seeing those guys, and I want them to work together. Like they're gonna work together remotely, but it's great to have them all together. Just get all their heads in sync, which I have to do because I need some more ideas. When Raz arrives at the Psychonauts headquarters, the Psychonauts kind of need him more than he needs them. They're just not the organization they used to be, and not the one that Raz always dreamed of joining. He's like, "What is up with this?" And he's told that his field promotion is not valid, and if he really wants to be a Psychonaut, he has to earn it here at the headquarters. And
is that Levi?
Levi! Yeah. If you were going to be able to join us.
It took me longer than expected to get all the psychedelic drugs.
Oh. And Raz finds out this guy was pushing everybody into researching not the normal Psychonauts powers, but necromancy. He was specifically speaking to the dead, which has been debunked by Psychonauts. They don't believe in it. They think it's just, and also it's seen as kind of has a lot of moral problems. They just don't like it.
Okay.
Yeah, it turns out Gristo was pushing them because he is trying to revive the long lost spirit of Maligula. Maligula.
And you're going off and you're just like debunk, you know.
Yeah, you're exploring the headquarters and finding all these
trying to find
areas,
the mystery, solving
and going
mystery.
Into different brains. And the main thing is actually going through a list of possible minds.
So just like a million, just try to like think so of like what just, some of these might look like.
You could just pick one, and then for a certain number of minutes, even just sit around all talking about it.
And then from the end of it, like we'll see all these different kind of maybe some crazy like gameplay mechanic might come out of it, and then all of a sudden like that's what you base something out of. And you're like, oh wait, actually that mechanic is cool. So maybe we could like turn that into we could work that into this side of brain.
I don't know. I say at this point just. Bombard Tim with a million things and then have him look around and kind of start making connections and figuring out how he wants to do it. And then we can come back and make all the worlds really amazing.
Because there's so many ways you can go with the brains, you know. Like I learned on the first game, people really liked the second half levels more than the first half levels. The later ones had like a crazy concept to the gameplay of them, whether it's that bubble moving through or the bull running through or all these things that twisted everything upside down. Like the setting is suburbia, the theme is paranoia, and the twist is that relative gravity twisting in the world.
Right.
Just try to make sure each level has each one of those things, you know?
Setting, theme, twist, there you go.
And so I'm realizing just like a level with a cool looking theme and funny jokes will not be enough. Each one really has to be this turning gameplay inside out new idea. So I'm really bringing all of the brains I can together to create a brainstorm. Oh, that's why they call it that. Pachinko world, like the entire time
is
falling down. Badoo, 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 badoo. Deep fried world.
Yeah,
I really like that.
These are great.
Like everybody's just
great.
Tempura. Like everyone is just delicious.
Gets dip.
Everyone leaves like a little trail of oil behind them wherever they walk. Wind Chime City. That's crazy. You just run through it the whole time.
Oh, pretty, dude. That'd be pretty.
Peter Pan Syndrome.
Oh, a new brain.
Yeah, a new brain entirely.
What is Peter Pan Syndrome?
Never growing up.
Never growing up. And it's like a Jungle Gym Fisher Price style world.
Hmm.
Oh, those guys. They're so good at what they do. I'm sort of I feel like the imposter syndrome where I'm like, yes, I know what I'm talking about. I don't know what I'm talking about. Okay, hey guys. And then they're like really good at drawing and I'm okay. Mm-hmm. I'm okay.
Yes, it's been amazing having Emily. Having like a female influence back there is actually pretty wonderful. I mean, she's like, even besides that, it doesn't matter. She has unbelievable ideas no matter what. But it's just great to have that dynamic kind of shift it a little bit. Has been really, really great. And and that must be tough coming into a situation where the guys that worked on it and were told bros for a long period of time in the beginning were so tight. It's hard to get into something like that, get into like that little circle. But it's absolutely no problem.
But it's cool to see their passion and they know what they're doing. And I'm sure they might feel a little imposter syndrome too. Mm-hmm. I feel a lot of artists have that, but they're good. They're really good.
This could be a kind of a creepy Children of the Corn style scenario where like all the kids and all the characters are having a blast and all the adults are like trapped and being tortured.
Stalker.
Yeah, that's funny.
Okay. Stalker mind, and this is so creepy, I'm scared of touching it. Or like, there's that feeling with Stalker, like I know this, I've watched all her movies and stuff, I feel like I know her, and if she could just meet me, she would really, I think we'd really be close. We've all thought that way, right?
Yeah, right? Really good. Yeah. I don't know, that kind of happens in real life sometimes too, where, I don't know about you guys, but when we were growing up and going to art school, you put are certain artists, like you go through your Society of Illustrators and you see these guys that you admire and you look up to them, right? And then you put them on a pedestal. And then you have the opportunity to finally meet them and they turn out to be dicks, right? Mm-hmm. And then you go, why did...
You don't like their stuff anymore. You don't even like their stuff anymore.
What a waste of your life.
Totally
yeah.
phony. And
and
you're disappointed after that.
Put them on a pedestal.
Then you stop putting people on pedestals.
Yeah. Well, we killed another column. Last column, and then we can do other stuff. babies, mind you guys. Is that adorable? Is that going to be the most adorable babies mind ever? Mind.
You just see boobs everywhere.
So like Nathan's mind, pretty much.
Well, it's a little different now because you don't live here anymore. You don't, you know, you're doing a lot of your own stuff. Like, do you want to be more of a part of it, or like, what's your
view? I feel that coming on. I do feel that vibe when I'm looking around at like the VR game and looking at what everyone's doing. I feel like, oh man, I really want to spend a lot more time with this, and I have that pull to come back and really be here all the time. But then again, when I moved to New York, I felt like it did free up so much of my mind. I was able to come up with ideas a lot, in a lot more of a smooth environment, smooth way.
Pretty cool. That's awesome. Cool. Rad. I love it.
Every once in a while, during this week, I would get that feeling like, oh my God, I just want to take this whole cast of characters and just draw them all, you know, like, and have a little awesome toy box, you know? And I feel like, in my mind, I'm like, oh, I can't wait to work with those shapes again. I can't wait to do that with a renewed strength that I've built through the years. I feel like really excited to revisit it, you know?
I'm telling these guys if you have ever wanted to email me things or okay. Any questions about anything.
Okay.
Or any.
Bug you?
Yeah.
Okay. We're gonna bug you, right?
Yeah. Later, right. Bud.
Yeah, I mean.
Thanks, dude. Thanks, dude.
All right, hey everybody.
Hey.
Thank you. Our team is getting so big. This is pretty awesome. And
put a new seat bench in the back for
everybody. Yeah, well, it got even bigger today because I really want to introduce Andy Alamano. I'm really happy to have him here, and he is going to do wonderful things. He's joining the team as a producer, so we now, I think, have the most number of production people in the company devoted to this project.
Does
so
that say
that,
about us?
That
we should start producing something soon.
I think it says that this is important.
And you are not the new guy anymore, Paul, since Monday.
I got to tell you, what as someone coming in as a producer working on a game, watching Double Fine Adventure has been a very, very eye-opening experience about watching a production happen in this company. It's been very, very informative to look at, like, how did things happen and why do you think things happen? That's been very, very educational. It's perfect timing, too, because production is about to start. It's going to start when we get back from Christmas break, and we're going to be going like full on production. I'm kind of getting prepared for that, and that's part of the process of getting started here and getting ramped up, getting ready to roll. Because we're a Psychonauts game, we want to make sure that we deliver this thing that people are like, oh, this is the Psychonauts I remember in VR. So art style is a big deal.
And then today we have a big kind of meeting with Peter and Scott, sort of helping guide. Give us some pointers and feedback on sort of their process when it comes to the style of Psychonauts.
And we can ask you questions sort of about a little bit about your approach when you're thinking about working on Psychonauts. I mean, now you guys are actually back into it again a little bit. I have a few examples. This is some work that Say's been doing. She's probably taken stuff the farthest as far as when is into production work. And I don't mean to put Say on the spot, but this is all, you know, this is her work.
This is your life.
This is her work, but you guys should feel free to sort of make any comments and things that you think would help push it into the Psychonauts world.
Cool. This is awesome. I would say, yeah, the Wonkify thing.
What do you want to say about it?
That was a discontinued term on Psychonauts because I said it too much.
First off, Say, great job.
So wait,
I love your work.
Yeah, these are great.
These are beautiful. What?
Peter is super mean.
Martin's like, going, oh, he knows. He took my class, so he knows. How I approach the Psychonauts world is that it's asymmetrical. Even though you've drawn it in a cartoony way, it's still proportionally correct. So if I was going to do it, I would try to make one side, you know, really bigger than the other or something like that, just to break it up. Okay, so if I was going to do a circle, I would put the center off a little bit. So it's like a person doing a caricature of a face. You try to find that one feature that you can kind of embellish on.
There's also the story that you're telling. I'm not sure if this is like, so the story is what? There's like a titanium here that everything is attracted to, everything is pulled to this point, right?
Yeah, it crash lands.
Crash lands. One thing I'd want to see is like this feels like it's like been just a pile, like everything's fell to it. It would be really dynamic if they all just like were pulled into it and just like mm-hmm. they crash landed into it. So instead of like kind of like this sort of thing, they all kind of were pulled towards this center thing. Maybe the shape is more like this. And you could see like this is the bus that went slamming in. This is this one that went slamming in. This is the little Volkswagen bug that went slamming in. You know, and this is like the plane. I don't know, whatever.
No, that's and that's brilliant. Because that's the thing about establishing shots. It should tell a story.
Yeah. One thing I always hear you talk about is like the tension between shapes, like the negative space too, like when something
almost
the tension
touches.
Is almost touches and stuff. And I love like this boat here is like everything is in this plane, but you have certain things that are still have not gotten to this spot. Like that I love that this boat is like just hanging on. Like that's so dope, right?
Yeah.
But it could be even more of a dynamic kind of.
But what would make it more dynamic is that it's teetering, right? Because right now it's sitting nice on that cliff. But if it's teetering and aiming toward it, then it looks like it's pulling in,
like
right?
Dude, that thing should look like it's pulling that cliff down with it, right?
So then, see again, that's. But then you also that means you also have to look at the negative space, and that always enhances the positive. All right. So that's that.
It was so hard to figure out what that style was. Now that we have that game done, we can look at it. We can just take that, and people have that have played it or working on the game, and everyone here that have gotten just way more skilled, we can kind of put that all together and just make, the blueprint is already there, and it's a real rough blueprint, so they could make it way better now. So that's, I can't wait to see what everyone does with it. So I'm cool stepping back a little bit and just kind of watching what happens.
And sometimes it's fun to just create a backstory when you're designing it too. Like for example, the reason why there's a giant A-frame around this whole thing is because the original house has a lot of roof leaks. So then I just deliberately drew a second roof over it. And then that way it forced me to come up with a different silhouette.
Mm-hmm. So, good work, dude. You nailed it with that design.
Okay. Gosh. So long ago, you guys.
Oh,
one. Yeah. Mm.
Mm. Wow. Oh, one, wow.
I think so, yeah. I felt good about it. Actually, like Peter and I were talking about when we did that demonstration, like if help was helpful for us to get back into the mindset of what the shapes are like and what the rules are like and stuff. It felt good for us. And so when we went back to the room to draw, we got even more inspired about it. So it was so fun to look at that stuff, man. I don't know. So I think it's going to be great.
The sound. I'm sure you've had a walrus on your front porch some mornings. Serious question, do you get walruses on the island? No? It's cold? Killer whales, no walruses?